Wow, Pravani, it's kind of dark in here.
Dark? Dark, Jason? Seriously? Guys, the rate. That's a bit of a racist comment, I must say.
Whoa, look, Pravani, look, I don't think I crossed the line there. I think you should really just lighten up a bit.
Lighten up? Do you hear yourself? Oh my. Foul. It's over. Goodbye. Guys, I don't know about you, but just on a lighter note, this topic is getting quite contentious. We know that more than ever, we are hearing people play the race card and speak about getting a bit more outspoken about how they feel regarding prejudices. And we're going to see what God's word has to say about that. We as the church cannot be silent. Jason, this is not the time to be passive. It's not the time to be silent or invisible. And so we're going to dive in. We're going to see what God's word says about how we as a community can tackle this issue together.
Guys, speaking about our country, guys, we do need to pray for our country. Let's pray for our leaders and let's pray for each other. But speaking about praying for each other, guys, the CARE project, guys, let's pray for each other. The link is below. Let us get into the sermon.
Well, good morning, Doxa Deo Hatfield. I hope you guys are doing well. I was asked and I was dared to do this. Morning, Hatties. How are you doing in the fields? That's an inside joke. I hope you guys are cozied up. Thank you for joining us in this time of fellowship. We're about to go into a time of worship where we're going to lift up the one and only true God, the sovereign God, the King of all nations. Come, let's worship Him.
Lift our voice with heaven, singing worthy. upon the praises of a thousand generations. You are worthy, Lord of all. Unto you the slain and risen King, with lift our voice with heaven, singing worthy, Lord of all. Spirit, flow living water, flow within us, flow living water. Your love is alive, it's breaking the darkness, it's bringing the light to soften the heart of stone. Your love is alive, it's breaking the darkness, it's bringing the fire, it's bringing the open time, Lord. Tando la co, la co, luya pila, luya pila, buso, buso, wako, wako. Among us, come Holy Spirit, flow living water, flow within us, flow living water. Your love is alive, it's breaking the darkness. To soften the heart of stone, your love is alive. It's breaking the darkness. It's bringing the fire. It's bringing the open hope. Tando, tando, lako, lako.
To you the slain and risen King, we lift our voice. Well, good morning, Doxa Deo Hatfield and everyone else joining us online today. It's so great to have you with us. Guys, we've taken another step forward and therefore another week closer to Sunday, the 4th of October, when we will finally be reopening our in-person Sunday celebrations, and we cannot wait. It's going to be a great moment for us as a church. Please make sure that you have all the detail for that. We are continuing to communicate as we move forward. It's going to be a great moment. But today is also really exciting because we have a friend in the Doxa Deo family, Llewellyn Venner. He's one of the ministry leaders at our Doxa Deo Raslo campus. He's preaching today as we take another step forward in our journey through this incredible book called Ephesians. And I think he brings just such an interesting perspective to this conversation. So I'm really excited about that. But just as we think about our giving and generosity, I want you to keep that in mind, that a percentage of every single Doxa Deo campus's budget goes toward the planting of new Doxa Deo campuses. So we are now the youngest of the 30 or so campuses we have around the world, but it's the generosity of thousands of other Doxa Deo partners around the world that has created the platform for us to plant this new campus in Hatfield. So think about the fact that we want to take the good news gospel to every city we find ourselves in. We want to see the lost reached and social pain and systemic brokenness addressed in each city. And every single cent that we give as the Doxa Deo partners is going toward that dream. So let's be people that are generous. Let's be faithful. Please make the shift to electronic giving in this season. Let's trust God for a harvest of righteousness globally, not just in Tswane. So let's hear from our partners, and you can get out your Bible as we jump into the sermon.
Good morning, Doxa Deo Hatfield. For my praise report today, I want to praise God for every spiritual blessing that we are blessed with in Christ. Ephesians 1 verse 3. I want to praise God for the faith that He works in us and for His love. I want to praise Him for His power that is working in and through us, and for hope that we can be people of vision who look forward to His glory covering the whole earth. I want to praise God for the Bible, for all 66 books, for how they were written and preserved over the ages, for all the translations, and for the many versions that we have access to on the internet, on our cell phones. I want to praise God for the wonder of prayer, that we have direct, unlimited access to God at any time. And I want to praise God for community, that we are not on this journey alone. Enjoy this morning's service.
Great, good day and welcome from my side. My name is Llewellyn Venner. I'm part of the Doxa Deo Raslo team, and it's so wonderful to share the word with you this morning. Thank you, Joe and the team, for the invite where I can be part of this amazing series, this journey of the ethnic blend, that a journey of diversity from the book of Ephesians. And I want to title my message this morning, it's not a race, it's a journey. And that's what we see in this whole idea of this ethnic journey through the book of Ephesians. And one of the things that I can say, if I think about diversity and I think about ethnic group, there's no other place I could start but by my own family. My own family, there's a picture of us, And you can see the difference, the diversity just in our family life. And our youngest, he's Zarih. As you can see, Zarih, we always say he's the Maori. He looks like one of those New Zealand guys. And then Jaden, he's a redhead guy, so he looks like Irish. And then obvious, my wife, she's Afrikaans. And then the colored in that whole picture. And that's the great thing about us. But you know what? We want to speak about this journey. It's not the race. It's a journey. And Ephesians is a first and foremost an encouragement letter because of the Christianity, it was the strong roots in the Jewish history and the religion of that. And it was the nature of the early Christians to wonder if Christ's gospel, that they were part of it. And was it just a limitation in regards to the Jewish, or was it we are part of it? And Paul comes and he explains and he shares this to them. And the ethnic, was it only the ethnic heritage, or was it we are part of it? And Paul, the dearly wanted to explain that the Gentiles, the brothers and the sisters, that knowing that it is not a Jewish culture or Jewish kingdom, it's a God kingdom. They are first class citizens in Christ. Just as the Jewish and their brethren are first class citizens, so are we. And we get to this point across them, and he uses certain analogies and phrases just to emphasize on it and make it stronger to understand that we are the body of Christ, that we are united, that we are God's kingdom on this earth. He uses the analogy of marriage, that there's two people that has come in union together, and that we are in the relationship of Jesus. And I know that Joe, in the few weeks, the past weeks, he gave an introduction regarding this whole book of Ephesians and where we're going to. And today, just remember about this whole aspect. It's a race. It's not a race. It's a journey. And we speak on this different ethnic groups in our church and in our life and in our society. It's so amazing to understand that this letter was tremendous encouragement to the non-Jewish believers who received this message from Paul while Paul was in prison, and that the Christianity wasn't bound to certain ethnic group, but it was that you are part and parcel of that we are included in the death and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And no matter your nationality or your ethnic group heritage, Paul's letter to the Ephesians filled and reminds us about this, that our faith is in Christ and not in our ethnic group and not in who I am and not in my culture or my inheritance. It's about Christ. I don't know about you, but I don't know if you have been lost in translation before, but I have been lost in translation before. I remember it was my first year, and here was this colored guy in this white community. And everyone that studied with me in my service year, everyone was white. And it was only me, myself, and I who was this colored guy coming from a colored community and a colored background. And you grew up in a colored home. And everything I understood about the colored culture was in me, rooted in me. And suddenly, I'm out of my depth. And here I am in this white environment. And I remember one thing. My one friend, he invited me to a braai. And this is a true story. He invited me to this braai, and I went with him to this braai, and he told me, listen, pitch up at 6 o'clock and so forth. And here I am, pitched up at 6 o'clock with nothing. No meat, no drinks, nothing. And he comes up to me, he's asked me, Llewellyn, where's your meat? Where's your, you know, don't you have at least a packet of chips, or don't you have a cool drink or whatever? And I said to him, no, I don't. And he said, don't you understand how it works? When we invite you to a braai, you bring your meat and you bring your drinks and you bring whatever you want to bring to enjoy this time. And I said to him, listen, whoa, you don't understand. In my culture, where I come from, growing up in this colored community, if I invite you to a braai, you just pitch up, you, yourself, and I, nothing more, nothing less. And I remember how we laughed about it. And he at the end said to me, don't worry, I have extra meat and extra drinks. I'll share with you. But it's that mindset of understanding that we are different. Although we have one thing in common as South Africa, we have braai in common. How we do it is different. And that helps me to understand that I was lost in translation for a little bit. but I came out of it. And the Apostle Paul comes and explains to us that we should not get lost in translation when it comes to our faith in Jesus Christ, because it's not what we did, but it's because of what He did for us. Listen to Ephesians 2 verse 13 in the NIV. It says, "But now in Christ Jesus, you who once were far away have been brought near by the blood of Jesus." Ephesians 2 verse, another translation says, Ephesians 2, it says, for it is the grace you have been saved through faith, and it is not from yourself, it is a gift of God. Understanding that we are looking into the scripture both to speak of Jesus and breaking it open, that the distance, there's no longer distance. We are now part and parcel of this faith, that we are included in this Christianity, this way, this lifestyle, and that I am part of it. There's a new king, and His name is Jesus Christ. A new king with His new reign and dominion, and suddenly I'm part of it, and I'm included in this message. I'm included in this lifestyle. He has brought me out of darkness into His marvelous light. In fact, that scripture says the following. It says, He has handpicked me. I'm part of Him. He has handpicked me to be in His kingdom and in His authority. See, the Ephesians letter is not about culture, just about the culture and diversity. It is about that they were different, but it is a celebration of the church, that they wanted to celebrate the diversity that is already there. And I think one of the things that we need to do in South Africa, and we need to do as a church, we need to start celebrating what we have in our diversity, in the different ethnic groups and multi-ethnic groups and so forth. We are part and parcel of one thing. It's a God culture. We don't have different cultures anymore. There's a kingdom culture. So Ephesians 2 verse 11 to 22 says the following. It says, "Therefore, remember that formerly you were, you who are Gentiles by birth and called uncircumcised by those who call themselves the circumcisions, which is done in the body by human hands. Remember at that time you were separated from Christ, excluded from the citizenship in Israel and foreigners to the covenant of the promise, without hope and without God in this world." So we were far away from God. We were excluded in the death and the resurrection of Christ. They didn't see us as part of this covenant, but Christ came and did something for us. It says, "For He Himself is our peace, who has made the two groups one and has destroyed the barriers, the dividing wall of hostility, by setting aside in His flesh the law with the commandments and the regulations." When I read that piece, breaking down the walls, I was thinking and reminded of the Great Wall of Berlin. Remember in those times, there was families, when that wall came up in the early 60s, it says that when that wall came out, there was families on the opposite side, on the west and on the east side, and suddenly this wall came up and they were divided, and families were on the other side. But I remember in 1989, when I saw that documentary, I could see the emotion of, now we are one, now I'm included. And His purpose was created in Himself, one new humanity out of the two. Thus making peace, He came and preached peace to you who were far away and peace to those who were near. He included everyone. He says, in one body, to reconcile both of them to God through the cross, by which He put the death to the hostile. For through Him we both have access to the Father by the Spirit. Consequently, you are no longer foreigners and strangers, but fellow citizens with God's people, and also remember of His household, of also members of His household, building on the foundation of this apostle and the prophets, with Jesus Christ Himself. And this foundation of the apostle and prophets, with Jesus Himself as the chief cornerstone, In him, the whole building is joined together and raised to become the holy temple in the Lord. And in him, you too are being built together and becoming a dwelling place in which God lives in spirit. See, God brought everything and Jesus took everything on himself. And Paul comes and explains to us and broke open that we could not understand this mystery. He comes and he says, listen, this is what you need to understand. You were far away, but I've brought you near. Jesus has brought us near and we are part of this. We need to understand that we are now part of this temple, this body of Christ. And being part of it is a privilege. Being part of it, knowing that we have been handpicked. And I just want to say, girls and ladies, remember, the Bible says that we are built into the temple as bricks. We are now part of it. If we as man can be called the bride of Christ, you can be a stone. And although the Ephesians had their own temple, Artemis, they had this beautiful temple and they couldn't understand why now a new temple. And Paul comes and explains to them, listen, I want you to understand that the old is gone. The new has come. We are part and parcel of it. There's a new identity. And notice this one statement that arises from Paul's exposition of Jesus Christ, the reconciliation work of him. He says, we should see to bring the future into the present as much as possible. We should almost be colorblind, as people often say, for one race is not unimportant, it is primary. We need to understand that. And I love what Helen Keller said. She said, the only thing worse than being blind is having sight but no vision. Can you see the future in terms of being one in Christ? Can we bring that future into our present? We should appreciate diversity and seek to bring all races and faces to Jesus, who binds us together in the unified as people. I don't know if for some of you would remember this, but in the 90s, there was this TV station or channel, Simunye, We Are One. And I loved it because it spoke of we are one as a nation. And another thing that we always hear is the whole thing of Ubuntu. And this one definition says, I am because we are. You see, when Paul writes to us in this letter, he never uses I that excluded the Gentiles. He always uses the words we, us, unity. The body, because it is that we unify with each other. The diversity testify of the power of the gospel, the power of this witness that we are part of the King Jesus Christ. We don't merely want to see diversity for diversity's sake. We don't want to do that, but we want to see it because of the gospel, who is central to it, that the gospel manifests through the lordship and the uniqueness of this church. The church is the front runners when it comes to diversity and different and multi-ethnic groups, but still we have one. And we have one thing in common, the kingdom of God, and we are part of that. It helps to clarify where the gospel fits in and why the gospel is so important. You see, the cross is a central point when it comes to this. It's because of the cross that there was forgiveness and there was reconciliation and there was hope and there was life and there was unity. You can read that in verse 14 to 17. Notice that Christ has done it. Everything that he did, every reconciliation that he did, everything, there's an action word towards it. He made it. He broke down. He abolished. He created. He reconciled. And we have to preach that. That's what happened in these verses, that there was action taking place. And now we have become one. In Galatians 3, verse 26 to 28, and we have heard this before. And he says, for all of you who were baptized in Christ, having clothed yourself with Christ. So in Christ Jesus, you all children of God through faith, there is neither Jews nor Gentiles, neither slave nor freeman, nor there male or female, For you all are one in Christ Jesus. And I believe what we need to do to establish this grace in our life, in this authority, this new culture, the kingdom culture, that we don't pull out the race card wherever we can or whenever it suits us, but we need to understand that we are now one. There's a grace card that we need to play. And there's three things that I want to share with you. The first is that we need to connect. Creating unities, facilitate opportunities to discover and to do life together. We need to share our stories. What's your story? I mean, one of my best friends was his father. He's a white guy and his father was in the army and he only had one thing. He only knew what it is to live with white people. And suddenly, yeah, this colored guy comes into his life and his whole life changed, not because of me, but because we shared our stories. And I remember this one weekend, this off weekend, when I said to him, come with me and come visit by me for this weekend. It was a huge eye opener for him because we connected over that weekend. I connected with him in his household and he connected with me in my household. That brings and creates unity. I think we need to collaborate because we are the catalyst of the future. We need to take action, identify social and spiritual and cultural goals that we can reach more effectively together. Let's collaborate as a church and in our city because God is calling you and I to be part of this. And the best thing that we can do is the last thing, and I'm ending on for this, is we need to celebrate. How do we celebrate? We need to cultivate transformation. We need to measure the positives and keep up the positives in saying, God, we know that you have done this because it's not just a religion, it's a relationship, and we are forming relationships with each other. We are joined together and building together. Each one is relating to another special way, and we are all growing together in Christ. Practically, it means that every person counts. We need each other. We need your talents. We need your time. We need your treasure. We need your love, your resources, and your encouragement because we are part and parcel of this. And I want to end off with this scripture in Ephesians 1, verse 20, 22 to 23. We as the church are the power and we need to see it. Listen to this. It says, The church you see is not peripheral to the world. The world is peripheral to the church. The church is Christ's body in which he speaks, he acts, and in which he fills everything with his presence. We are the hands and the feet of Jesus Christ. And let's do this with our diversity. Let's celebrate what we have as a church, as Doxa Deo Hatfield and as Doxa Deo Raslow. We are part and parcel of a new culture, a kingdom culture. And there's a new king in our midst and he wants to be part of our lives. His presence is with us. Let's pray together. Father, thank you for this opportunity that no matter who we are, no matter what our background is and what our history is, Lord, we know what our future holds. And our future is Jesus Christ and his kingdom, his lordship over our lives, his word and his opinion over our lives. And I want to pray, Father, that we will start living and moving and have our being in our new identity. And that's the opinion of Christ over our lives. I pray that we will really walk together, live together, and that we will celebrate as we journey through the book of Ephesians. Because that's what you want us to do as a church today. We need to celebrate our differences, not just as Doxa Deo, but Lord, as a church in the corporate. I pray this, Lord, in the wonderful name of Jesus. Amen and amen.
Well, Doxa Deo Hatfield, I hope that you had an awesome day with us, getting into the Word, worshiping together, and we're excited about what God is doing. So if you're in a space where you need prayer, we've got a dedicated prayer team that would love to pray with you. So you can just look in the description for the links, and we would love to stand with you in prayer, whatever the request would be. The second thing is that we encourage all of our people to become partners of Doxa Deo Hatfield. So a partnership is what we call membership in this church. If you've not gone through our partnership process yet, please look at the links in the description. We would love to facilitate you regarding partnership. Finally, as always, we're going to be praying together in the boiler room on Zoom just after the service. So please meet us there. It's the engine room of our church. It's where the spiritual heat of our church is generated, I think. And we would love to have you with us in prayer. Have an awesome week, and we will see you again next week.